Now, the issue before the Supreme Court for answering is, what should we do with regard to the grounds taken application of this 75% threshold to 66% as a retrospective amendment? As you know, that 75% was the threshold limit when this plan was put to vote, and it could not muster that 75%, therefore it was rejected. The claim of the appellant is, at the time of NCLAT considering, say that 75% has been reduced to 66%. So, it should have, the Honorable NCLAT must have considered that effect, and then this should be considered as a retrospective or retroactive amendment. Now, Honorable Supreme Court refused that argument, but in support of that, saying that this is not to be considered as a retrospective. Actually, if you analyze it, there is a fairness in the appellant's arguments, because one is the object of the insolvency code is to run the company, CIRP, rather than liquidation. And then this 25% people are creating havoc, and practically, you know, public sector bankers are really, they are not bothered about the survival of the companies. So the Honorable Supreme Court was worried that the commercial decision of Committee of Creditors should be given paramount importance. Maybe they could say yes, but still that might open up a Pandora box. That was the reason why Honorable Supreme Court went at length to explain why this retrospective amendment cannot be considered to be operative. In other words, they said that you see, when in any exam you want to pass, there is a 30% marks above, 40% marks above. If you are writing top exams like CA, you have to get 40% minimum, 50% in aggregate. So higher the bar, higher will be the difficulty. So whether 75% is giving too much leverages to the financial creditors and that is resulting in liquidation, whether the 25% people having voting share below 25% cannot trouble the majority holders, is that is the basis. And now that instead of 25%, that option is given to 34% up to the 34%. That means financial creditors up to 66% can decide the fate of the resolution plan. So in support of that, the Honorable Supreme Court has taken the discussion, what is this Insolvency Law Committee March 2018 took up, what was the reason for all these amendments? They wanted to go through that legislative intent. This particular judgment seemed to depend heavily on the legislative intent and the strict interpretation of the code. That was given paramount importance, rather than that is the commercial wisdom of the Committee of Creditors, faster resolution process within 270 days, were the guiding lights of the Honorable Supreme Court. Therefore, even if the other arguments were better, still they were going through this. Because giving a retrospective amendment, okay, would not, and exclusively saying this applies only to this, would have opened up the Pandora box. So the Honorable Supreme Court must have been on the opinion that this economic legislation must be made to work means the judicial intervention should be very minimal, and they only have to interpret and see that timelines are followed. It's, that's what I understand. So let's see how the Supreme Court tried to convince the arguments. That report 11.1, section 21.8 of the code provides that all decisions of COC shall be taken by vote of not less than 75% of the voting share of the financial creditors. Regulation 25 subsection power 5, read with regulation 26 of CIRP regulations, provides that if all members of COC are not present, an option to vote through electronic means must be provided. It was represented to the committee that the high threshold of 75% of voting share of financial creditors for decisions of COC was proving to be a roadblock in the resolution process. effectively as a result of high threshold, blocking the resolution plan and other decisions of COC was easier than approving this. So they felt that two paragraphs are clearly saying that, why are you reducing the threshold from 75% to 66%? The committee considered the fact that so far various benches of NCLT have passed liquidation orders in 30 cases. 76 out of these 30 cases, how is this 76? In 76 cases which have come in for CIRP process, orders for liquidation went in for 30. Only 9 cases went in, I don't know, that wording is not so clearly done. I think 30 cases have been decided. NCLT passed liquidation orders in totally 76 out of 30 cases, only 9 cases went into liquidation on account of rejection by COC. Further, only in one case a liquidation order was passed owing to lack of consensus of 75% financial creditors for approval of the resolution plan. 77 in respect of remaining 8 cases, the plan was rejected by an overwhelming majority of voting share, above 80%. Thus, the empirical evidence suggests that the apprehension that companies are being put into liquidation by minority creditors is premature. The committee reiterated that the objective of the code is to respect the commercial wisdom of COC. The committee noted the voting thresholds across other statutes and guidelines that deal or have dealt with the rehabilitation of the companies as follows. A. Section 230 subsection 6 of CA, that is Companies Act 2013, which deals with the power to compromise or make arrangements with creditors and members, provides that any compromise or arrangement must be approved by 75% in value of creditors or less, or class of creditors or members or class of members as the case may be. So they've taken that provision. Section 1262 of Companies Act 2013 provided for a scheme of rehabilitation which required approval by one, secured creditors representing 75% in value of the debts owed by the company to such creditors, and two, unsecured creditors representing 25% in value of the amount of debt owed to them. Further, in case of voluntary wind-up, Section 311 of Companies Act 2013 provided for replacement of the company liquidator by approval of 75% of the creditors or 75% of members of the company. The Joint Lenders Forum framework formulated by RBI, which has now been replaced to enable creditors to identify and deal with distressed assets at an early stage, prescribed a voting threshold of 60%, reduced from 75% of the creditors by value, and 50%, reduced from 60% of creditors by number in JLF, for proceeding with the restructuring of the account. Section 39 of the SFSE Act provided that in the case of financing of financial assets by more than one secured creditors or joint financing of financial assets by secured creditors, no secured creditor would be entitled to exercise any or all of the rights conferred on her under the relevant law, such as taking possession of the secured asset or takeover of management of the borrower, unless the exercise of such right was agreed upon by secured creditors representing not less than 60% in value of the amount outstanding as on the recording date. Now, invariably, Honorable Supreme Court was justifying that 75 threshold was there. But the issue that is put before Honorable Supreme Court is not 75% is genuine or not. The 75% has been reduced to 66%, and at the time of adjudication by NCLAT, 66% was prevailing, and the object of CIRP was IB code is to revive the companies, and therefore you give us a chance of life. That is what the issue that is being deliberated. But this data, I am not too clear. 75%, why this insolvency has committee taken and why it is reduced to 60%, that's okay. But here they wanted to have a retrospective effect because of the reasons mentioned. That is yet to be answered. They further went, the report mentions that empirical records suggest that apprehension regarding companies are being put into liquidation by minority creditors is premature, and further that the objective of the code is to respect the commercial wisdom of COC. As aforesaid, the amendment of 2018 cannot be considered as clarificatory, but it envisages a new norm of threshold for considering the decision of COC as approval of the resolution plan. The Amendment Act of 2018, having come into force with effect from 6th day of June, therefore will have to have only prospective application and apply only to the decisions of COC taken on or after that date concerning the approval of the resolution plan. So, what broadly the argument put forward by the Honorable Supreme Court for saying it is only prospective is that the 75% threshold is a well-considered thought. Therefore, and they reduced 66% not because this is another decision they have taken, that's all. Like that they were arguing, which I think it is not a strong argument compared to the petitioners, appellants who took that stand is a good stand. Reliance was also placed on by the resolution applicants and the shareholders, a stakeholder supporting the resolution plan of the concerned corporate debtors on the decisions of the court in Venkata Krishnam Raju BK. That question, that was what Abhishek Singhviji took up, BK Educational Services Private Limited and State Bank of India. And all that cases, they took up the pair of 15. Zail Singh versus State of Haryana. Ordinarily, whenever the word substitute or substitution is used in the legislature, by the legislature, it has the effect of deleting the old provision and make the new provision operative. Fine. The process of substitution consists of two steps. First, the old rule is made to cease to exist, and next, the new rule is brought into existence in its place. The rule is that when a subsequent act amends an earlier one in such a way as to incorporate itself or a part of itself into earlier, then the earlier act must thereafter be read and construed as if the altered words has been written into the earlier act with pen and ink and the old words scored out, so that thereafter there is no need for to refer the amending act at all. That is, no doubt, in certain situations, the court, having regard to the purpose and objective sought to be achieved by the legislature, may construe the word substitution as amendment, having a prospective effect. Therefore, we do not think that it is a universal rule that the word substitution necessarily or always connote two severable steps, that is to say, one of repeal and another of fresh enactment, even if it implies two steps. However, the aforesaid general meaning is to be given effect to unless it is found that legislature intended otherwise. So, relying upon this judgment, what they say is, that is, you are reading 75%. Now, when you say substituted, it is like removing 75 and then it is to be put at 66. So, that is very clear. That means the data from which it comes, you have to read it as 66 only. Now, insofar as present case is concerned, as discussed here and after, the legislative intent was also to give effect to the amended provision, even in respect of those inhumans which were serving in service as on September 1, 2016. The court has restated the position that there can be no hard and fast rule merely because of the usage of expression substituted in the Amendment Act. For in certain situations like the case on hand, the amendment will have prospective effect as it is not intended to reverse or nullify the decisions already taken by the COC of the concerned corporate debtors before coming to force of the amended provision. Here, if you see, the Honorable Supreme Court primarily was looking at the overview of the situation which will develop if you say it is a retrospective amendment. When you say retrospective amendment, everything can be reopened. So they don't want that to happen. Even though where that substitution is the word, it says 75 has become 66. Whether it is from that date or whether that will apply to the previous ones. So that legislative intent was also given in that particular judgment. So what they are saying is, a substitution necessarily always cannot two severable steps. That is to say, one repeal, the old one has gone, and another a fresh enactment, even if it implies two steps. So substitution means you first erase that 75 and then reintroduce 66. Now the question is whether 66 is from 2016 can be taken. That is called retrospective amendment. No, it should be taken from now onwards, a prospective. And there is no hard and fast rule. The law has never said that if you say the word substitute, it will apply only prospective. That was not been read into that decision. That is why situational legislative intent is being checked. But finally, Honorable Supreme Court took this view. This court in Tirumalai Chemicals Limited was Union of India others, in para 23 observed that it is a trite law that every statute is prospective unless it is expressly or by necessary implication made to have retrospective operation. These propositions have been re-